2018 special, Election Security, Protecting Your Vote.
Hello, everyone. I'm Brian Collery.
And I'm Stephanie Gorin. For the past 3 months, we've investigated election security here and across the country. We've exposed vulnerabilities in voting, cybersecurity warnings ignored, a lack of urgency and money to fix the problems before Election Day, and gaps in state and federal preparedness.
Those gaps even after the director of national intelligence said the warning lights are blinking red for another cyber attack. But we found, despite the threat, state and federal government have not done all they can to protect the midterm elections. Chief National Investigative Correspondent Mark Albert explains.
We assume Russia's campaign targeted all 50 states.
Homeland Security Secretary Kirstjen Nielsen delivered a blunt warning to the country's top election officials. No state is safe from cyber threats. So too did the country's intelligence director.
Today, the digital infrastructure that serves this country is literally under attack.
Do you think states are doing enough to take the threat seriously?
Yes, I do.
Tom Hicks is chairman of the U.S. Election Assistance Commission, which just handed out $380 million to states to strengthen their voting systems. But nearly 70% of the states waited more than 2 months to ask for the money. Now that the last state, Maine, requested it, there's no requirement they spend it to protect November's midterm elections.
How long do states have to use that money?
They have 5 years to use that money. So,
would you advise them to use it sooner?
Exactly.
And that's not the only missed opportunity. As of July, just 18 of the 50 states had asked the Department of Homeland Security for free risk and vulnerability assessments. DHS wouldn't reveal which ones, citing security. And only about half of state election officials eligible for permanent security clearances from the federal government have them. They need that clearance to receive ongoing classified information about threats. We asked Chairman Hicks about that, and were stunned at his answer.
Security clearances take time to get through.
Right, so about 88 of the 150 eligible have.
So, for instance, my security clearance has not come through. I've requested it, but we're working to make sure that it's done correctly.
So the chairman of the Election Assistance Commission does not yet have their security clearance?
Correct.
Isn't that a problem?
Well, we're working on correcting that problem.
That's a problem.
Jim Condos is the Secretary of State of Vermont and the President of the National Association of Secretaries of State.
Next up will be Charlie for the state of Mississippi.
Condos showed us the scale and scope of the ongoing cyber attacks on his own systems.
We're getting upwards of 2 million hits a day. Approximately 800,000 of those we suspect are unauthorized attacks.
800,000?
Correct.
That's 40% of all web traffic every day to your state websites you believe could be malicious.
We believe that that's so.
That's a stunning number.
It is. In fact, it shocked me.
And that's just for Vermont. DHS told 21 states hackers probed or attacked their election systems in 2016. This year, a dozen states have at least one precinct that uses electronic voting machines that do not leave a paper copy of cast ballots, making it impossible to recreate a tally with paper if someone tampers with a machine, leading House Democrats to label those states and six more as the most vulnerable in the nation. Still relying on paperless machines worries Condos.
You believe that the states that use voting equipment that do not keep a paper record of every cast ballot should change their election machines?
Yes.
Why?
Because we think that going back to paper is necessary to protect the integrity of our elections.
One estimate found replacing all paperless machines and fully securing elections would cost $1.4 billion. Updating 11-year-old guidelines at Chairman Hicks' Election Assistance Commission would cost far less. But the only federal agency focused full-time on elections has just two of its four commissioners, so it can't pass any new policy to protect the vote.
The fact that there is no quorum, I think, is unacceptable.
The White House just nominated a third commissioner, former Virginia Elections Chief Donald Palmer, but a hearing in Congress has not been scheduled. Also in Congress, a bill called the Secure Elections Act has bipartisan support, but has not yet been given a floor vote. And even with the threat of cyber intrusion still high, the White House eliminated its top cyber coordinator position in May.
Just recently, election officials in Montpelier spoke out about detecting a malicious attack. Investigators say it originated in Russia. This particular attack was on August 24th. It included the words Russian Federation in the code. Officials reported the incident to the Department of Homeland Security.
Every single day, we are receiving thousands of malicious scans, and we call them scans. It's like a burglar going around your house and jiggling the doorknobs and checking the windows to see if they can find a way in. But the good news is we blocked them. We had our defenses in place and they didn't get anywhere.
The Secretary of State says the scans poked at all of their major election computer systems. They do not believe software or data was compromised.
The White House has tried to assure Americans that it is doing enough.
This is a threat we need to take extremely seriously.
The Trump administration's top security officials in August promised a vast effort is underway to protect our elections and that they're more resilient now than when Russia attacked the 2016 campaign.
We acknowledge the threat. It is real. It is continuing. And we're doing everything we can to have a legitimate election that the American people can have trust in.
But they also acknowledge a pervasive, sophisticated campaign by Russia and possibly others is underway to steal information from candidates, spread division on social media, and corrupt our elections.
Cyber experts sounded the alarm, meeting with election officials at a national summit in St. Louis, who vowed to remain vigilant, but some may be falling short.
There has been resistance, yeah. There's-
That's Eric Hodge of Cyber Scout, an Arizona cybersecurity firm. He briefed secretaries of state from across the country in St. Louis in September.
This is a real high priority and something that I would have hoped would have been addressed in some places maybe a little bit more aggressively than it has.
What I'm worried about are attempts to manipulate voter confidence.
Homeland Security Undersecretary Chris Krebs will oversee a national situational awareness room on Election Day. DHS has promised to improve the sharing of threats with the states.
Those threats come into a command center few have ever seen. Coming up, we take you inside the government's cyber combat effort and reveal the security warnings so far ignored.
Then, which candidates have been targeted so far this election? But next.
We were too slow, and it meant we missed things.
A confession to us from Facebook. Now meet their troll hunters. What social media and tech companies are doing to protect the vote. Our election security special continues right after this. Just like in 2016, this year hackers tried to launch cyber attacks against candidates and campaigns. California Democrat Hans Gierstead says he was the target of a very sophisticated digital attack. The hacks on Gierstead's campaign and company began in August 2017 through a fake email that tricks recipients into allowing access to their emails. Meanwhile, Microsoft said it blocked an attempted breach against three congressional candidates, and reports suggest an unknown number of senators and their staff have seen their private email accounts targeted by foreign hackers. That's according to one U.S. senator.
Social media and tech companies have stepped up their efforts to try and stop threats to the midterm election, employing vast numbers of troll hunters, as Mark Albert found when we went inside Facebook.
I've heard you're described as Facebook's top troll hunter. Sounds intimidating.
This is a really big team working on this problem.
In fact, the team Nathaniel Gleischer works with as head of cybersecurity policy at Facebook just got a whole lot bigger.
So we've doubled it.
Doubled to 20,000 people in just the past year, all focused on election security, cyber threats, and content review.
We have data science experts. We have threat intelligence experts.
Gleischer showed us around Facebook's New York offices. The founder of the world's largest social media company, Mark Zuckerberg, just 2 days after the 2016 election, flatly dismissed the idea that fake news on his platform played a role in influencing the election.
I think is a pretty crazy idea, right?
But this year, Zuckerberg told lawmakers he had changed his mind.
We didn't do enough to prevent these tools from being used for harm as well. And that goes for fake news, foreign interference in elections.
We were too slow, and it meant we missed things. And what we've been focused on is making sure that that doesn't happen.
That's why this is such a high priority. That's why we're laser focused on this.
In advance of this year's midterm elections, Facebook says it has taken down 1.3 billion fake accounts, built an election war room and expanded partnerships with federal agencies, rolled out free security tools for candidates and campaigns, and launched an ad transparency database. Voters are dubious. A poll last month found 80% of Americans have no confidence, or not very much, that what they read on Facebook is true. Meanwhile, Twitter tells us it is also stepping up election security by removing hundreds of accounts pretending to be members of various state Republican parties, or which appear to originate in Iran. But it may fall far short. New research finds 89% of Twitter accounts that spread fake and conspiracy news in the 2016 election remained active earlier this year. Microsoft says it blocked an attempted breach against three congressional candidates and tells us it launched a Defending Democracy program that is now protecting more than 30 campaigns.
Are the social media companies doing enough to protect our elections?
I think there's no question, absolutely no question in my mind, that everybody is taking this problem, this challenge seriously, including the social media companies.
But there is a limit to Facebook's transparency.
You can't tell us how many candidates or campaigns that you reach out to because you suspect they've been a target.
No.
I notice on the wall right next to us it says be open. Is Facebook being as open and transparent as it should be on this topic?
We've been pretty driven to be as open and transparent as we can be. In any security space, you always have to be careful that what you're doing isn't playing into the hands of the threat actor. So we have to be careful.
Facebook says it's also helped protect elections in France, Germany, Mexico, and Brazil. Coming up next.
Is this just for show?
No, so this is not make-believe. This is stuff that's actually happening.
We take you to DEF CON as hackers expose vulnerabilities in our voting systems.
Plus,
is the federal government doing enough to counter the threat to the elections?
Tough questions for DHS inside its secure cyber combat center. Even with Election Day just days away, we've learned vulnerabilities still remain in the security of how you cast your ballot and get the results. Here are the risks to your vote and the returns on Election Day.
In Las Vegas, land of luck and legend, a bunch of hackers rolled the dice to see if they could expose weaknesses in our elections. And they did. Some while playing a winning hand, a hand with yellow fingernails, cartoons, and stuffed animals.
I am 11 years old.
I'm 11 years old.
7 years old.
11 years old.
And 7 and a half.
These kids managed to manipulate replicas of election night results pages in key battleground states from 2016.
We're moving to Iowa.
Pages built, organizers say, using actual vulnerabilities previously reported.
Is this pretty easy for you?
Yeah.
To prove it, Jonathan Lenski from New Hampshire made it appear as if I won the election.
Oh my gosh, and there's my name. 87 billion votes. Wow.
Is this just for show?
No, so this is not make-believe. This is stuff that's actually happened.
Jake Braun helped organize the Vote Hacking Village at this year's DEF CON, the world's largest convention of hackers.
Ah, there you go.
Hundreds of whom scanned, screwed,
what do we have here?
And sabotaged 9 different types of actual voting equipment.
You're looking to hack it?
Yeah, basically.
Why?
I want to help secure these things.
Among the flaws hackers say they found, a voting scanner and tabulator still used in up to 24 states, according to the group Verified Voting, with no password or software verification to prevent it from being overridden. A touchscreen voting machine that hackers reprogrammed to play music and animated clips. And an electronic poll book machine that signs in voters on Election Day, hacked in 5 seconds, potentially exposing unencoded personal information on voters.
Many of the local election officials take this defensive posture and think, oh, well, we're criticizing them. Like, we're not criticizing them. We're saying, hey, look, the game has changed. But it's not about them. It's about protecting our democracy.
Even though 100 local election officials came to DEF CON, the National Association of Secretaries of State criticized the hacking as a pseudo-environment that in no way replicates accurate protections. We reached out to two of the biggest manufacturers in the industry, Dominion and ES&S. In a statement, Dominion cautioned its best practices do need to be followed to ensure the integrity of the unit. ES&S told us, physically accessing these machines in a polling place would be difficult, if not impossible. Having said that, we welcome the input from the voting village and constantly work to bolster security.
That's a directory.
Ooh, yeah, baby.
Even if a voting machine is not hacked or ever connected to the internet, there are ways to affect the results, researchers tell us.
A very accurate replica.
John Sebas of the Open Source Election Technology Institute in Silicon Valley set up for us a replica tally manager, software that adds up results from the precincts after the polls close.
Go.
We timed how long it would take to change the winner.
It's loading the data.
Using a single disk with malicious software brought back from a mock polling place where the machines were never connected to the internet.
And here we are, we're done.
So 22 seconds and you've just changed who won that election.
Yes.
We think these are very important systems and deserve the very best, not only in security, but engineering and in design and experience of the people. They're that important.
But so far, not all systems are the very best. A group of researchers announced they found nearly one out of every three candidates for the U.S. House of Representatives has campaign websites with some sort of security error.
What is your message to the American people?
Work on your computer security, people.
Senator Ron Wyden of Oregon warned that 44 million Americans use voting technology that, in his words, make hackers and hostile foreign governments salivate.
Every day, DHS is fighting cyber threats to the elections in a secure command center. Homeland Security invited us for a rare tour inside the nation's hub for cyber combat, giving us a briefing on some of the latest threats and weaknesses.
Behind this locked steel door somewhere in Northern Virginia, America's fight in cyberspace never shuts down.
This is the place where we coordinate everything.
Jeanette Manfrub is the Department of Homeland Security's Assistant Secretary for Cybersecurity. She invited us onto the watch floor of the National Cybersecurity and Communications Integration Center, known as NCIC.
So you could see election threats on this map?
Absolutely.
This team, operating 24 hours a day, detects, analyzes and responds to cyber threats against the elections and the country. On election day, this map would show stark red if a severe cyber incident struck while Americans voted.
Is the federal government doing enough to counter the threat to the elections?
You know, I do always think we could do more. I think we are doing everything we can right now. But it's a long process.
As we found in our ongoing investigation, that process has been slowed by turf battles, a lack of money, resources, and in some cases, urgency, and disagreements over strategy.
The federal government's own record of security is pretty abysmal.
That's Congress's top watchdog, who told lawmakers the federal government has failed to implement 1,000 of its cybersecurity recommendations.
You know that people are going to see that headline.
I absolutely know that people will see that headline. We take GAO recommendations very seriously, and we're working diligently to close those that we agree with. Sometimes we disagree on what those recommendations are, not usually, but sometimes we do.
In research done exclusively for the National Investigative Unit, the GAO found Homeland Security actually disagrees often, not implementing 44% of the watchdog's cybersecurity recommendations. But Manfred says progress to strengthen election security is being made. DHS has quadrupled the number of intrusion detection sensors on state election systems since 2016. Here's why DHS says that's important. Every day there are millions of attempts to penetrate U.S. networks. When those early warning systems installed on state election networks detect an attempted intrusion, many of the alerts within 15 minutes go to a watch center for cyber threats in upstate New York. It then sends suspected breaches targeting elections to that NCIC site outside Washington. It's like calling the fire department. To help put out the cyber fire, analysts sound the alarm across the government, even deploying go teams to state capitals to douse a cyber breach or catch the hackers in the act.
In 2016, after the elections, DHS said about 21 states had some sort of detected malicious activity trying to get into their networks. How many states this election cycle have you seen?
None.
None?
Not yet, no. But remember, in 2016, it was later. It was closer towards the actual election.
Do you worry the next shoe is about to drop?
I always worry the next shoe is about to drop, but everybody is much better positioned to be on the lookout for these sorts of things.
Experts say the federal government would be even better positioned if it would fill the 15,000 IT positions currently vacant.
Still ahead, we'll check back in with those kid hackers.
More of what those kids had to say coming up next. We're committed to covering election security now on Election Day and beyond.
Stay with NBC 5 News on air, online, and on mobile for the latest on the vote, the candidates, the issues, and the results. That's our Commitment 2018 promise to you. For all of the NBC 5 News team, I'm Brian Colleran.
And I'm Stephanie Gorin. We leave you with more from the next generation of hackers. We'll see you on election night.
My name is Cordy, and I am 7 and a half.
My name is Bianca Lewis.
I'm Audrey Jones. I'm 11 years old.
My name is Yarrington Lenski, and I'm 11 years old.
My name is Alex, and I'm 7 years old, and I'm hacking into voting.
It took you 10 minutes to hack the website.
Well, I was kind of distracted at the time.
Is this pretty easy for you?
Yeah.
Is it hard or easy to hack the election?
It's actually really easy. I bet the Russians could do it in their sleep.
Why do you say that?
Because, well, it's not that secure. I think America as a whole thing should just work on its computer security. Programmer, you have to know how to do it the opposite way over. So I'm trying to do this for me to learn how to hack different things and then find the bugs and then try to fix it.
You haven't decided whether to use your powers for good or evil?
I'm leaning towards good.